Good evening. Good evening. Good evening to everyone. It is a wonderful, wonderful evening. I've had a wonderful, wonderful day. And I just want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to join me tonight to hear from God. So I'm going to tell you, like I normally tell you, come on in and make yourself comfortable. Greet everyone as you come in. My name is Pastor Steph, and I'm one of the pastors of Place of Refuge Ministries. And this is True Talk Tuesday. This is where I'm going to ask for a few minutes of your time to have true talk discussions about earthly issues with the Word of God as our spiritual counselor. I want to greet everyone. I want to say, forgive me. But I didn't put my glasses on, and I'm not sure why. And now I know why I keep squinting, trying to see. So please forgive me. But oh my goodness, that's a whole lot better. Good evening, Sister Kendria. Good evening, Sister Joni. Good evening, Brother Darius. Good evening, Sister Linda Publix. I'm so glad that you guys could be with us. I'd like to greet all of our first-time viewers and say welcome back to those of you who've been with us before. And if you've been with us before, you know I'm going to ask you to like, comment, and share this post with your friends. Or better yet, put their name in the comment box and that'll give them a personal invitation to join you. This is known as cyber evangelism. Who knows? Maybe a word may be spoken tonight that could give them answers to questions that they've been wanting to ask. We'd love for you to go directly to the Place of Refuge Ministries Facebook page and join us in the comments there. Before we get started, I want to let you know that our prayer lines are open, and at any time during this broadcast, you may call for prayer at 563 265 7255. That's 563 265 7255. And also, should you choose to make a financial donation to this ministry, you can do so one of three ways. That's via our Cash App, and our cash tag is $Place of Refuge, or through PayPal, and that's at Place of Refuge, or even by mail. The address is Place of Refuge Ministries, 518 Brown Street, just like the color, Davenport, Iowa, 52802. I want to thank all of you who support this ministry through your giving. We have people who donate on a regular basis, and we may not be able to send you a thank you card, but I want to tell you thank you so much. Thank you for your giving. This allows us to further the ministry through the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we appreciate it so much. I want you to join with me in prayer this evening. Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you, thank you, thank you for your love. Thank you for another day. Thank you for being our Savior. Thank you for being our Creator. Thank you for knowing that you are patient with us. Thank you for loving us in spite of our mistakes and our downfalls. Thank you for looking beyond our faults and seeing our need, because that's just the kind of God that you are. You love us in spite of us. And God, we give you all the glory. We thank you, oh God, for another day that you've given us, another day to work out our soul salvation with fear and trembling. Thank you, God, for this night. For this night, we have gathered together to hear from you. God, we believe that you are going to speak to us tonight. We believe your word. We're going to grasp hold of it. And God, we are going to use it, Lord God, to enhance, Lord God, our spiritual walk with you, to enhance our relationship with you, God, draw us closer to you. Draw us nearer to you. God, you said that if we draw nigh to you, that you would draw nigh to us. And here we are, God, to hear from you. Now, God, we're asking that you would open the ears of the hearer. Lord God, use my mouth as the pen of a ready writer. God, speak through me. Let me take a back seat because this is not about me, but God, it's all about you. And then God, after we've heard your word, help us to not be like the man who looks in the mirror and forgets all about what he's seen or what you've shown him. God, but help us to be doers of your word. We give you all the glory because you alone are worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Again, I say thank you, thank you, thank you so much for being with us tonight. I gotta ask you a question. What is the reason for doing what you do? Every single person has a deep motivation that fuels their life. To be sure that God is pleased with your actions and your motives and to enjoy an abundant life, you need to know exactly why you do the things you do or get engaged with the things you get engaged with. I venture to say that if you're unhappy with your life, if it seems crowded, where sometimes there feels like there's confusion in your life, you're probably doing the opposite of what God created you for. John 10:10 says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly." The last thing the enemy wants you to do is to fulfill your God-given purpose. So he'll flood you with distractions. And by distractions, I mean the things that will take up your time that have nothing to do with God's design for your life. He comes to steal your purpose, to kill your purpose, and to destroy your purpose. He does not want you to fulfill that. Ask yourself, what are your motives? Are your motives for what you do pleasing to or bringing glory to God? 1 Corinthians 10 and 31 tells us whatever we do, to do it all to the glory of God. That's what God has called us to do. Bring glory to him, not to ourselves. And it's not about us. It's all about him. What is your why? Our scripture focus this evening is in Genesis chapter 11. Verses 1 through 9. And this is how it reads. Now, the whole world had one language and a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used bricks instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, if as one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so they will not understand each other. So the Lord scattered them from there over all the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there, the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. God had commanded the people to be fruitful and multiply and to migrate all over the earth. If you remember, we talked about Noah last week, and we talked about Noah's faith that was to the saving of his whole family. And then if you'll look in Genesis chapter 10, it talks about, at the end, it talks about that as Noah came out of the ark, God told him, now I want you to be fruitful and multiply over the face of the earth. So God had commanded people already to be fruitful and to multiply and to migrate all over the earth. But these people decided they had a better plan than what God had come up with, period. They decided to move to Nimrod's city of Babylon and settle there. They thought they had an ideal spot because they were right in the valley between the Tigris and the Euphrates River. So they had plenty of what they needed. So they decided that they were going to build a city and settle in that city. Now, this was outright, blatant disobedience to God's command. Apparently, Nimrod wanted them in his cities, and he wanted to be in control of God's people. Here's a fact. God will always have his way. Just because you choose not to be obedient does not mean you can force God to change his mind. When God says something, that's exactly what he means. I don't care how many years has passed. I don't care if everybody is accepting of it. But once God lays out his law, that's what he means. He said that they were to be fruitful and to multiply over the face of the earth. God is not going to change his mind. Proverbs 19:21 says, I need y'all to listen to this. There are many plans in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel, that will stand. But listen to this in the Message Bible, because when I read it, I just had to laugh out loud to myself. In the Message Bible, Proverbs 19:21 says, we humans keep brainstorming options and plans, but God's purpose prevails. I don't care what you come up with. You may think you know better, but God's purpose will prevail. The tower they built was known as, now I'm not really sure if I'm pronouncing the word right, but it's a ziggurat. And I remember studying history in school, and I remember pictures of the ziggurats. A ziggurat looks like a pyramid. And this pyramid had steps and ramps up the side of it. Now, they can stand nearly 300 feet high. And often they're about as wide as that also. But at the top was a special shrine. And it was dedicated to a god or goddess of their choice. These ziggurats were usually the focal point of the city. The structure was so large, it could be seen from far away. There was absolutely no way to overlook it. So this project was an arrogant slap in the face of God. You're gonna build a ziggurat, you're gonna build a structure that will reach up into the heavens. And then you're gonna, on top of that, you're gonna put your god or goddess on top of it. How much sense does that make? Let me put this right here. And I need y'all to pay attention to this. And I'm just going to say, I shouldn't say I need y'all to pay attention to this. I need us to pay attention to this. Because when God's word goes forth, even though it may be coming from my mouth, he's talking to me too. I don't get to opt out. The husbandman must first be partaker. Listen to this right here. Be careful of the shrines you build on God's property. Mm-hmm. Be careful of the shrines you build on God's property. You know what? Somebody who types, I want you to type that in the comment box because I need this to be seen. Be careful of the shrines you build on God's property. The Bible tells us you're not your own. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The land and the material that God created is what they used to build a shrine to another god. Be careful of the shrines you build on God's property. They used his knowledge and his strength that God gave them in order to build a shrine to the god of their choosing. Be careful of the shrines that you build on God's property. I think of some of the secular music today. God gives a person a beautiful voice, gives them a talent to write, and gives them a talent to put music to it. And then the things that come out of their mouth is a slap in the face of God. Be careful of the shrines you build on God's property. The people in our text were resisting God's command to repopulate the earth, but they decided to create a way to stay together. They did not want to move around, to spread out over the earth. I don't know if it was fear, I don't know what it was, but they decided we're going to do something different. We're going to figure out a way that all of us can stay right here in this one little area. Don't that sound like some of us today? Some of our churches today? We're trying to figure out a way that we can stay together when God has told us to go out into the highways and the hedges and to compel men to come in. Let me move on. I know I'm just meddling. But again, I want to say, be careful of the shrines you build on God's property. This was much like the early church, whose mission it was to take the gospel of Jesus Christ all over the world. But it wasn't until persecution came and saints were starting to be martyred that they began to move out. Sometimes God's got to send turmoil our way to get us to do what he told us to do. Sometimes he got to get you fired in order for you to move where he wants you to move. He told you 2 years ago to leave that job because he had something different for you to do. And you thought you would just hold on. And I'm talking about myself because that's exactly what I did. God told me to come off that job and I'm steady trying. There was a point I was trying to get to. I thought if I could just make it up to this point, then I'm going to quit. God said, I said what I said. And you don't get to change my plan. So sometimes you got to force you out of a place in order to get you to move. I'm telling y'all, that hurts. It hurts your pride. It sure ain't mine. But listen, when God talks to you, they just decided they wanted to stay together. Beyond their disobedience was their motive or their why for what they were building. Verse 4 says, then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens. So that, now here's the reason. Here's the reason. Listen to their reason. So that we may make a name for ourselves. So that we may make a name for ourselves. Their why with this build was they wanted to make a name for themselves. So that other people would go by and say, whoo, look at that. Look at what them people built. Whoo, they must be talented. Look at that. Their purpose sounded eerily similar to the serpent's lie to Eve in the garden. Remember what he told her? You will be like God. When you get to the place that you want to be admired, and you want people to ooh and ah all of you, and you want people to say how good you are, you put yourself in the place of a God. And that's a dangerous position. You weren't made for that. They were one people. They were on one accord. They were speaking one language with the same mission in mind. They had the same desire. They all felt the same way. We're going to make a name for ourselves. But one thing was missing. God. They didn't get his permission. They didn't get his approval. They didn't even ask. Be careful. When you make up in your mind that you want to put yourself in God's position, when you want to be God, when you make up your mind that you want to be God, you may just lose your mind. Hear me what I'm saying to you. Here's an example. Remember King Nebuchadnezzar? He got so high-minded that he wanted people to worship and bow down to him. So he built a statue that was 9 feet tall. You ain't gonna miss this. A statue of himself, not just any statue. And then when the music is played, I want to see all y'all bow to me. You might want to be careful. God caused him to lose his mind and sent him out in a field to live like an animal. His nails grew, his hair grew, and he ate grass like an ox. And what makes so bad? His son made the same mistake. Remember we talked about train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he won't depart from it. This is what he offered to his son. So his son comes along and decides, here's what I'm going to do. He has a party. And when he has this party, he gets drunk. And then he decides, I feel like I'm worthy to take the vessels out of the temple, well, the vessels that his father had taken out of the temple in Jerusalem, the gold vessels that were to be used in the tabernacle. Remember? He took those and decided, I'm going to drink wine out of it. Huh. Sometimes when I read certain things, I cringe. Oh, no, don't do that. But he got that bold that he decided that's what he was going to do. And when he did, a hand came and started writing on a wall. Fear set in. He sent around to try to find somebody to explain to me what this means, what this writing says. What does it say? When he finally came, I got him up with Daniel. And Daniel said, God, not pleased with what you did. Belshazzar died that night. And another one, and it split the kingdom. You can't play with God. My brother-in-law said, there's only one God. I ain't him. Neither are you. That's a dangerous position. Then I did a study on King Herod. King Herod was so bent on killing Jesus He felt like he was paranoid. He felt like Jesus was going to take his place. Common sense should tell him, Jesus would not want your place. Yours is a natural kingdom. He had an eternal kingdom. But he was so paranoid, he became vengeful. And they tell me, studies show, that King Herod, he got gangrene on the inside of his body. And his body began to rot. And he died in the floor of his kingdom. Y'all remember Adolf Hitler? He destroyed millions, thousands of Jews. Because of jealousy, they've had so many ideas of what they felt like, different studies of what they felt like was the reason why he hated the Jews, and he felt like that his race was superior, and then they said that he was even part Jewish. I'm not really sure. I'm just saying. But he was jealous. But then he took his own life when he could see that he was losing the war. And then World War II would be over with. It caused him to take his own life. He shot himself. Proverbs 16 and 18, some of you probably knew where I was going. Proverbs 16 and 18 says, pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. When the people of Babel said, let's go up, God said, let's go down. Their bold disobedience was met with the Almighty God's power and judgment. Don't ever get to the place where you feel that you're God's equal. In the words of James Weldon Johnson, young man, your arms are too short to box with God. You will never be able to spar with God. Not even close. But I'm going to tell you something. Because of the mercy of God, he graciously spared their lives and gave them an opportunity to return to him. That's the God that we serve. He had the ability to kill them on sight. However, he just used their punishment to deter future incidents of this nature. He decided, okay, I see. Since y'all can get together and get on one accord, how about if I send you something that confuses that oneness? And the Bible says it confused their language. He confused their languages. And they were not able to understand each other. They couldn't get it together. Sometimes God uses confusion. But I'm gonna listen. Let me tell you this though. 1 Corinthians I want to say it's 14. If somebody knows where that's at, put it in the comment box. And it says that God's not the author of confusion. He's not the author of confusion. But when you have disobedience, you set yourself up. Because God has designed us to go this way. And when you decide I'm going this way, confusion ensues. And I believe that time God uses, okay. He uses that confusion to humble us. And to keep us going in the right direction, no matter how much you struggle to go your own way, God is gracious enough to bring you back. He's gracious enough to use disgrace. He's gracious enough to use embarrassment. He's gracious enough to humble us and say, this is what I need you to do. I'm trying to spare your life. Many of us are guilty of trying to make a name for ourselves rather than humbling ourselves and allowing God to exalt us in due time. Listen to this. God told Abraham that he would make his name great. And he didn't need any help doing it. The spirit of pride and greatness is prevalent not only in the world, but also in the church. It's a spirit that I gotta be better than you. Every generation wants to build its own towers. Every generation of people. Remember, I told you last week, there's two types of people. Everyone can be put in one of these two categories, either faithful or faithless. And the faithful trust God and his plan for their lives. But the faithless says, I got my own plans. I'd like to do it my own way. Building their own towers. Kind of when I was thinking about the towers, it made me think about one of our former presidents and his tower that is in his name. And sometimes I look at his attitude and some of the things that he does. And I pray for him because he doesn't understand that he's putting himself into a dangerous position. When Pastor Tom and I felt the call of God to start Place of Refuge Ministries, it was to reach a group of people that we felt had fallen through the cracks. And some of them told us just that. That they were being either overlooked or not accepted by a lot of ministries. They felt like they had no place else to go. For one reason or another, they just could not fit into some ministries. God laid it on our hearts to place a building in the middle of a forgotten neighborhood, in a homeless community. Where our church is, you see homelessness, disparity, the downtrodden. and they walk up and down the streets every day and every night on a regular basis. And we see it. And my heart breaks for some of these people. Some of them look like they have no hope, but we know better. And our mission in this community is to let them know that there is a God who loves them. And even though they were born in sin and shaping in iniquity, it doesn't have to be like that. And let them know that because they're in sin, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. But understand, somebody took their place. You don't have to die like that. And it is our job to explain to them, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him would not have to perish, but have everlasting life. That's our mission. And not just ours, wherever God has planted you as a child of God, that's your mission. That right there is the gospel. I need to explain to you that the gospel is not meat and drink. What you should eat, what you should drink, what you should wear. That's not the gospel. We get hung up on clothes and jewelry and who does this and who does that and who goes there and who goes there. But that's not the gospel, people of God. The gospel is that Jesus Christ was born. He died and was buried, and he rose again on the third day just for us, so that we would not have to pay the penalty for sin. He took that for us. He took our sins and laid them upon his back and carried them upon that cross and shed his precious blood for us. You don't have to live like that. You don't have to die with the sentence of sin on your life. It's not necessary. Our desire has always been to restore, rebuild, and reconnect people back to God, back to their family and friends. Because some of these people, their families have written them off. And back to the community. At times that has meant that we've had to feed them. We've had to clothe them. We've had to house them. We've had to employ them. We've prayed for them. We've preached to them. We've cried with them. We've hugged them. And unfortunately, we've even had to bury some of them. When you have a desire to do something, first inquire of the Lord. And then ask yourself, what's my motive? Be sure it is to glorify God, to bring attention to him and not to yourself. I see every day so many people struggling, or I shouldn't say struggling, I'll say fighting to, they feel like God has called them to preach. I agree with them. He has. But the minute they feel like that God has called them to preach, they feel like it has to be in a pulpit on Sunday morning. But you stepped over your coworker. You stepped over your family members. You stepped over friends that you see every day. You stepped over your neighbors because you felt like your ministry had to be in the pulpit. Let me explain something to you. God has called you to preach a message, but it always doesn't have to be the words of your mouth. You could preach a message by the life that you live. We're living epistles, known and read of all men. That's the word of God. I'm just telling you, that's what the word of God says. The life that we live preaches a message. I can't remember if it was who it was, but they were saying, I can't hear what you're preaching for watching what you're doing. Don't let your actions preach a message that is contrary to what's coming out of your mouth. Ask God, show me my motives. Last week, Pastor Tom and I, we were invited to visit a sister church, and we assumed we were there just to worship with them, and because they had a special service going on. However, it was also, I guess they were surprising us. So when we got there, they were giving out certificates of appreciation. And one they gave to this young lady who, she's an organist and she plays beautifully. And she has such a humble spirit. And anybody who asks her that they need a musician, she'll come and play. And she plays so humble. She even plays humbly. But beautiful. And they gave her a certificate. And I thought, wow, she really, I appreciate her even. And she's been doing it for years. And then they said, this next young couple, they feed the homeless. You guys need to see what these people do. And he just went on and on. And I thought, oh, wow. Maybe we need to get with them and see what they're doing. Maybe we can combine the ministries if that's what they're doing. It's feeding the homeless and stuff. And they called our name. Pastor Tom and Pastor Tom. I was like, what? So we went up and got our certificate, and I came back and I sat down and I said, God, this is for your glory. This is not about me. Always help me remember this is not about me. Whether anyone gives a certificate of appreciation or not, this is what God has called us to. And we'll receive our crown. We will receive our crown one day, whether nobody ever says anything, because we're not doing it to be glorified. We're doing it so that God can be glorified. I refuse to take credit for anything that God does. And this is definitely a God thing. This is not a Pastor Steph and Pastor Tom thing. This is a place of refuge ministry thing. It's a God thing. We live in a confused world. Babel is still with us. People walk the streets every day confused about what's going on and confused about life. But understand that God still has those who seek him for direction and choose to point others to him and not to themselves. I want to give you three ways before we go. Three quick ways. And you know I'm about the little short ways. I don't have no 20 ways. I don't have no 40 ways and all that. Just three. Three ways to examine your motives. Number one, ask God to search you. In Psalms 139:23, it says, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Number two, ask yourself hard questions. Am I doing things to be recognized? If criticism and attacks come against me for what I'm doing, will I quit? Will I quit because I didn't get a certificate of appreciation? Do I manipulate other people to get my way so that it goes in my direction? Am I always me or I-centered? Am I only in it when there's something for me? Philippians 2:3-4 says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others." And then number three, ask God to align you with his plan. Proverbs 3:5-6, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path." What is your why? Ask yourself, what is my why? Why am I doing this? Take some time to yourself. Take some time alone with just you and God. And tell him, "Reveal to me, God, my motives. Show me. And then put me on the right path. I want to be in your divine will." Before we go, I'd like to invite you to join our weekend service on Sunday at noon, either in person or virtually. And then I'll be right back here again next week to talk with you some more. Until then, make God your place of refuge.